welcome everyone and thank you for taking time out on this weekday. Mr. Rajiv Khandelwal is the co-founder and executive director of Aajeevika Bureau. Aajeevika Bureau provides lasting solutions to economic, social and legal problems of migrant workers directly as well as through its partners. By creating replicating models of offering services and security to workers both at source and destination. In his role, Mr. Khandelwal oversees the organization's strategies, programs, liaison, fundraising, and capacity building functions. Over the course of his 30-year career, he has held leadership roles in a range of non-profit organizations, implementing programs, conducting research, and providing advice and guidance to NGOs, donors, and governments in Rajasthan, India. He has worked for many years with the tribal communities of southern Rajasthan, implementing large-scale agricultural change programs. The idea of Aajeevika Bureau took seed at a time when he saw a significant change in livelihoods from farming to wage labor. Mr. Khandelwal was named as an Ashoka Fellow in 2005 and the India Social Entrepreneur of the Year in 2010. He holds a degree in rural management from the Institute of Rural Management, Anand. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together in welcoming Mr. Khandelwal.
My task today is to bring a little bit of the context that affects where I come from, affects people from where I come, but also generally in the country, and that is the context of rural to urban migration. It is not an isolated phenomenon. It is not something that affects people only when there is drought or when there is a natural calamity, but it is more a way in which people have figured out their livelihoods, in more in which they are coping with the very large scale distress in rural areas, a lot of which is, to my mind, not just an accident of fate, but a result of the kind of development model that we have chosen for ourselves, which has put people out of farming and into unregulated, poorly protected, low value kind of labor market situation. So this is a map that is a little bit in kind of progress, and we keep trying to monitor or map movement of workforce in the country. Where are people moving from and to where? And it's actually a very rich map because it shows that from the poorer, more impoverished parts of the country, which is more north and east, there is major movement to west and south. And this actually will impose very well on a map of relative prosperity in our country. You know, so wherever there is agriculture distress or in kind of endemic poverty, people get out of those rural areas and try to find work. The historical, the well-known kind of corridors earlier used to be eastern Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Jharkhand, going large numbers of people moving to Delhi, Punjab, Mumbai, but new corridors have come about. And some of those are very, very, I would say, counterintuitive. For example, large numbers of people moving from northeast, especially from Bengal, Assam, to Kerala, you know, which is linguistically so different. It is huge distance to travel. But today, Kerala has become one of the biggest, largest recipients of migrant workers. Almost about 45 lakh people in Kerala work as construction workers and as people in plantation and in plywood industry and in fishing industry and so on and so forth. These are big shifts, you know, to us. It may be just driven by employment, but they also have a telling kind of an impact on people's lived experiences, their cultural kind of identity, and are posing new challenges of integration and assimilation, you know, within the country. From where I come, which is Rajasthan, which is South Rajasthan, our labor corridor is really Gujarat and Maharashtra. Relative to other labor movement corridors, it's a short one, you know. So our people are not traveling thousands of kilometers. They actually go a few hundred kilometers and find work and come back and then go back again. And I think in that is also the feature of movement of people in our country. It is not permanent relocation. Rural areas are not emptying out and permanently. People are essentially moving out seasonally, coming back, going back again, coming back again. Because their engagement with the city is economic, it is not social or cultural, it is essentially for work. Cities anyway are too hostile to be permanently settled. It will take many, many years for people to find gain a foothold and gain kind of permanency in cities. So a lot of migration that we understand is actually seasonal and circular in nature. Yeah? And and that also creates new challenges of creating responses or thinking about how this move, people on the move, people who are between these two worlds of rural and urban India, how should they be served or be protected better. This photograph I often show because this is from just outside our office in Ahmedabad, and these are not unemployed people. These are construction workers. They are people from Banswada, and this is how they live for about 8 months in a year. Okay, and their families are just on the side. The women and children are on the side, you know, pavement on the side, and this is where they are. And so this is also indicative of the lived reality of workers in the city. You know, they ought to have had a home and a space to be living in dignity, but this is what most kind of workers are likely to be living like. Yeah, the age of migration from really, especially from tribal areas, from which I know better and I understand a little bit better, the average age of first entry is actually 13 or 14 years. Now at that point, there is no hope for gaining any skills, you know, any skills put you at a slightly higher end on the value chain in the employment kind of scene. So a lot of migration is very unskilled, and advancement will not happen by itself. You know, if you show up in a city as an unskilled construction worker, you're most likely to remain unskilled. You will not just automatically become a skilled worker because of your arrival, you know. You need actually favorable caste networks or some extraordinary, you know, kind of destiny to turn into a skilled worker from an unskilled work. Largely, migration is, you know, is employment or deployment in lower end, riskier, hazardous kind of work. There is usually a long chain of intermediaries, of subcontractors and contractors. And it's interesting in how several pockets of our country, there's a complex system of labor recruitment that now exists, and where agents, labor agents, commission agents are operating to round up workers and bring them to work, right? So labor kind of movement itself is a business by itself, and their value add is just finding labor and placing them and earning some commission out of that. So it actually puts into serious peril the rights of the worker, because the worker is actually employed by the intermediary. It's not just about situation being bad in rural areas, it's also about what is the condition that people are facing in cities. And our cities are very exclusionary, and that photograph also kind of made home that point that these are not people who are very included. Housing, sanitation, kind of, you know, they don't really, are not formally served to migrant workers who are living in these kinds of conditions. In our country, portability of entitlements is a problem. Now, what does portability of entitlement actually mean? It means that if you have a ration card in your home and in your village, you can't take it to your city and claim ration from a PDS store. It means that if you're a beneficiary of a social security scheme and you're in your own home state, you can't go and claim the same healthcare or any other protection from the receiving state. Civil society organizations, NGOs, also because they get kind of, they start to work in binaries of rural, urban, youth, farmer, you know, they miss out on this segment, because also this is a traveling segment, it's a mobile segment. I meet a lot of organizations in urban areas who will work with low-income groups and with slum dwellers. But even in their own kind of contact, they would have missed out on this population because it remains invisible. They would still work with people in slums. Now, people who have actually come to the slums, who have a space in the slum, have moved one step further because they have a foothold in the city now, but who are not in the slum yet, or who are just living in kind of rented rooms or in what I described as degenerated peripheries, that's not very easy for NGOs to reach. And, you know, you'll see a lot of missing kind of populations from NGOs kind of reach as well. There are many parts of the country where migration has served as an escape from just brutal caste kind of politics and caste kind of violence. And many, many, many people will admit to that, that a situation of extreme hardship in cities, you know, would be still preferred to a life of great indignity in the rural area, right? So that's the kind of reality that they're okay to opt out of. As I said, the average age of first entry is 13, 14, 15 years of age. But if you note this, actually the average age of return and retirement is about the time when our own work lives are peaking, which is about 35 years of age, right? So to have a workforce and an economy that is shaping its kind of future on the backs and strength of people who are retiring at 35, that needs to be questioned. Now, why is that? Why is that happening? There are two or three kind of very primary reasons. Wages are not going up, okay? Wages are low anyway, and they do not, they're difficult, it's difficult for people to continue being in the labor market at low wages, especially with high food inflation, high cost of living, high cost of transportation, and with indebtedness in the rural area not going down, okay? I think that understanding informed, it became the starting point of our own work and thinking about what do we ought to do. And I think our initial thinking was that we need to create a model that speaks to this reality and that addresses the problems that migrant workers face. We are in an area, in a geography that sends out thousands of people, and we need to start addressing, speaking to that major kind of reality of our region and also of Gujarat and of Maharashtra, where our people finally end up. And so the idea was to start looking at providing more comprehensive kind of services that help in reducing migration hardships, but also look at policies and knowledge that are shaping this big piece in our economy, that, you know, especially around migrant workers. So can migration be rendered into a more positive, into a more dignified opportunity? That was the kind of question I think we set out to answer when we began in 2004. We are a non-profit organization. We started simultaneously in Rajasthan and Gujarat, understanding that work at only one end would not be sufficient, but we have to be present in both ends. Yeah, we began, this is in pre-Aadhaar days, because 2004-05 Aadhaar had not really happened. And I think at that time to us, the major thing was to give people an identity, give them a number, give them a sense of association and affiliation. So we started to issue an ID card, right? So that was all. And it was also a means of establishing numbers and how many people are going out. So we registration and identity documents is one of the big pieces of our work. It was quite, at that time, quite pioneering, I would say. We set up a large legal aid program, which is helping workers who are facing wage disputes or bondage or exploitation at workplace. We set up a whole activity around skill training of workers, helping young workers get new opportunities in cities. There's a program around offering financial services, which is bringing credit, insurance, remittances, and pensions to migrant workers. There's an activity which is now turned into a full institution, which is around healthcare for migrant workers, especially those who are facing kind of acute kind of situations at work sites and workplaces. Looking at organizing and bringing more agency and more linkages of women to local entitlements, but over and above, promoting collective action and promoting unionization among workers. Currently, in our own research and policy work, we are trying to understand the dynamics of labor migration. You know, how is it changing? With the change in industry, what is happening to labor recruitment and labor retention? What is the future of labor in India, and especially in big urban markets, with the changes in technology and changes in the way capital operates? How will labor actually get employed and will get compensated? A good example, for example, is, you know, you'll be familiar with this, the whole gig economy or the whole engagement of logistics people, people delivering stuff to your doorstep. What are they? Are they workers? Are they entrepreneurs? You know, how do you classify them? They are actually being projected as micro-entrepreneurs, which is a ridiculous kind of a projection because they are paid very low wages. They are penalized for late deliveries. They have no social protection. And this is the way the new market has emerged. And it is a celebrated market, right? So what does e-commerce do to new commerce, new classes of workers who are depending on, you know, wage labor and who need a job? And this is the kind of job that they will finally get. So those kinds of policies need to be addressed more squarely.
I just read last month in the UK, they formed a cooperative of these workers you mentioned about the delivery workers, exactly to address some of these issues that... So again, there is opportunity to
form cooperatives there. Yeah, hi. So I have actually briefly worked in Udaipur as a fellow with Seva Mandir. I was in Govinda block. So I have observed some of the things that you've mentioned. What I would like to know is, I also worked in Uttarakhand where I saw a different form of migration, where it was more positive, where people were migrating for better opportunities and actually with families and staying more permanently in Delhi. What are the factors behind more positive forms of migration where it leads to more upward social mobility and more inclusive of, nature?
You know, like most things in a country, there's a caste element to this, okay? So there is a certain kind of caste determination, there's a caste determination of migration outcomes, you know, that if you were to be of a upper caste, your networks and your social capital and your access to economic opportunities would be better, right? The Uttarakhand migration story is also a story of a certain caste movement, right? Which is not repeated in the more tribal or the Dalit kind of belts of our country. And that is one explanation to what brings it. What are the other ways in which family migration can happen, in which more positive things can happen? I think it has to do with the provision of services, the provision of infrastructure and services and protection that reduces costs that workers face.
How have the employers' responses been towards the services that you provide? Have they been receptive, or how has that side of the fence been?
It's a good question because as far as it doesn't affect their interest, they're okay, na? Matlab, you give them skilled workers, for example. If you do skill training, we have a large skill training program. I didn't talk much about it, but if you say we are skilling people for your industry, and here are these people, and they're very happy with that. Skilling really sells. It's seen as a very positive contribution to the economy. It's another thing that our industry practices are very bad. So skilling actually is not rewarded very well. In our legal aid work, a lot of our kind of discussion and negotiation is actually with lower level contractors and agents, okay? And I think they are themselves down the value chain, and they are trying to settle. They're trying to bring some resolution to their own. They're also troubled by, what monies they have not received from their senior contractors and their employers. I find that in the thousands of cases that we have of this kind, we haven't had the kind of pushback that I had expected initially. I would say so far we did a count last year, and we found we had about some 25 cases of serious pushback, and there was some threat of violence or some police action or something like that's happened. When you've done 13,000 registrations and 25 cases are not very much. This is what you deal with.